Hello everyone. So today is our next topic, which includes again prescription and the CCS. So similarly to the previous day, I will be discussing the theoretical part of the prescription and in CCR, and then I will move on to the prescription writing. Yesterday I told you about what is prescription and what are the various types of prescription. Excuse me. In that, what I told is the prescription is it's a written order from a competent authority, and who writes drugs in that, giving the details of himself and the patient. So that contains the drug name. There is a specific module or a model by MCA. MCA says what are the what should be the parts of the prescription, and in the prescription the drug has to be written clearly with legible handwriting, and the drug's name should be in capital letters, and obviously the drug should be in generic name, not in the brand name, but the hardly it is being followed. The second thing which I told was the prescription types, and there are two types. The first is pre-component prescription, and then second is extemporaneous prescription or prescription. The prescriptions which are meant for the pre-component preparation are known as pre-component prescription, in which the drugs are prescribed which are already ready to administer form, like tablet, capsule and all. You need not make it first. The pharmacist need not make it first. So the doctor just need to write the name of the drug, generic name, and then when you show the prescription to the pharmacist will be dispensing the ready to administer drug. The second is the extemporaneous preparation, or the extemporaneous preparation. It is meant for the extemporaneous preparation. That means that here the ingredients would be written by the doctors, and then those ingredients has to be mixed with the given quantity, and then it will be made to a specific dose form, and then it will be dispensed to the patient. So this is known as extemporaneous preparation or prescription. Regarding the parts of prescription, the parts of prescription are of can be divided into five. The first is superscription. The next is inscription. Then subscription. Then direction to the patient, and then last signature. So the one topic is related with epilepsy. Another topic is related with migraine, and the third topic is related with congestive heart failure. So I'll be saying you brief about all these topics, theoretical part, and then I'll be moving on to prescription. Then here introduction. This I have discussed yesterday also, but then this topic is related, so I'll do it once again. So what is epilepsy and what is seizure? Epilepsy and seizure are not one and the same. There is a misconception that epilepsy and the seizures are same. Epilepsy is a complex symptom. The origin or the cause may be different, and it includes many a things, in which seizure is one of the thing. So epilepsy is a heterogeneous symptom complex, and it's a chronic disorder in which there may be a recurrent seizure. Epilepsy describes a condition in which a person has a recurrent seizure due to a chronic underlying processes. So you have a chronic underlying diseases or some problem or processes due to which the person experiences recurrent seizures, and this becomes epilepsy. Epilepsy also refers to a clinical phenomena rather than a single disease entity. So it's a phenomena which comprises of many things, many disorders. And it's a disorder for neuronal excitability. Whereas seizure it includes the finite episode. It includes the finite episode of brain dysfunction resulting from abnormal discharge of several neurons. So when there is abnormal discharge from the neuron of the brain, then it produces some kind of electric shock like thing, and that becomes a seizure. And it's a paroxysmal event due to abnormal excessive hypersynchronous discharge from an aggregate of central nervous system neurons. What is the nature and mechanism of seizure? Now see, as I told that it's a disorder of neuronal excitability. So when your neuronal excitability is increased somehow because of some reason, then you may experience the seizure. Okay. Or when there is inhibition of defensive system, then also the person may comes up with the seizure episode. So in short, we can say that when there is a reduction in inhibitory synaptic activity, we all know that GABA is the inhibitory neurotransmitter. So when inhibitory synaptic activity is reduced further, that means the neurons are easy to excite. Neurons are easy to stimulate, and thus seizure may appear. Or if there is increase in the excitatory synaptic activity, like glutamate, as we know that glutamate is a stimulatory neuron, a stimulatory neurotransmitter. So when the activity of this very neurotransmitter is increased with the neurons, on the neurons, then also the person may experience the seizure episode. What are partial seizure? There are many types of seizure. I'll show you what are the various types of seizure. But for the time's sake, you just say that partial seizure, in that there are neurons which undergoes depolarization and fire action potential at higher frequency by opening of sodium channel. And this opening of sodium channel is for the prolonged period of time, which needs to be stopped in order to treat it. For generalized epilepsy, this arises from a reciprocal firing of a thalamus and cerebral cortex. In this thalamic neuron, there is stimulation of T-type of calcium channel. And that is why there is the T-type calcium channel inhibitors used for treatment of absence seizure. Then genetic cause includes juvenile myoclonic epilepsy, JME, or childhood absence epilepsy. The details has already been taught in the respective chapter, so I'm just going through. So this I was talking about, this is the classification of seizure, and this very classification I have taken from Harrison of 17th edition. Now, seizures can be divided into partial seizure, primarily generalized seizure, and unclassified seizure. So the partial seizure, it is again further classified to simple partial seizure, in which there is involvement of motor, sensory, autonomic, and psychic signs. Then we have a complex partial seizure, and then partial seizure with secondary generalization. So it will be for a partial seizure, and then it will be converted to generalized seizure. So this is known as partial seizure with secondary generalization. The next class we have is a primarily generalized seizure. The origin is primary only. So primarily generalized seizure, and in this there is absence seizure, which is also known as paroxysmal seizure. Then we have tonic-clonic seizure, which is also known as grand mal seizure. So in place of paroxysmal, if absence come or vice versa, then you should not be confused. If the question is asked that prescribe for a case of tonic-clonic seizure, then if you have been taught that prescribe for a case of grand mal, the answer will be the same. Then we have the tonic seizure, then atonic seizure, and then the myoclonic seizure. The next third class is unclassified seizure, in which neonatal seizure and infantile spasm comes in. Just an overview of the types of seizure. The first which I told was the partial seizure. Partial seizure, the name is given because there is a specific part, a specific portion, a specific locus which is involved of the brain. So this is known as partial seizure. And in this, what the person feels is chronic jerking of an extremity lasts for 60 to 90 seconds. Of an extremity, important is that, of an extremity, not all the parts. Then a residual weakness means after this seizure episode or attack, the person may feel the weakness for next half an hour. The person will not lose consciousness and then he would be aware of what's happening surrounding him. Next is complex partial seizure. This was all about simple partial seizure. Complex partial seizure. Again, here it is a localized onset. As I told, the partial seizure is all about localized onset only. And then later on, it widespreads bilaterally. Bilaterally, both sides, it will spread. There will be aura and the alteration of consciousness is there. Stagger or fall may be there before the person may feel the seizure episode. He may come with an aura that he will get to know that the other person get to know that he is going to have the seizure episode. Then automatism, you will see there is lip smacking, residual tiredness will be there. So that is known as automatism. The third part was the partial seizure, secondarized, generalized, and that, as I told, there would be partial seizure first and that would be converted to generalized grand mal seizure or tonic-clonic seizure. That's why the name is, the name involved both the type partial seizure, secondary generalized. Coming to the second part, which is generalized seizure, generalized chronic, first was generalized tonic-clonic seizure or grand mal seizure. There you can see tonic rigidity of extremities. Extremities, you can see that there is rigidity on the part of the body. Then tremor would be there. And then clonus part will come with massive jerking. And then duration may go up to from 60 to 120 seconds. See, the major part of the body involves in this. The duration is shorter, but involves most of the part of the body. So you can see tonic-clonic name comes from the web because the first is tonic seizure and then tremor and then clonic seizure would be there. So the name tonic-clonic seizure of grand mal epilepsy. Next is absence seizure or petit mal seizure. There is sudden onset and abrupt cessation. All of a sudden it will start and then all of a sudden it will be stopped also. So the duration varies from 10 to 45 seconds. Consciousness may get altered. So the person may become conscious. Then mild clonic jerking of eyelid can be seen and extremities can be seen with postural tone change or automatism. Next we have tonic seizure, in which there is a tonic jerking, tonic rigidity of extremity. Next we have atonic seizure, when there is no tone left in the body, extremities, and then that there is sudden loss of postural tone, and then the person, if he's standing, he will fall all of a sudden because of the loss of the tone of the extremities. If the person is sitting, there is head and torso suddenly drops forward. So again, there is loss of tonicity. The person cannot have support its part, and then there will be a drop of the head and torso. Then chronic and myoclonic seizure, it may occur in any type of seizure, where is infantile spasm, there is epileptic syndrome, sometimes fragmentary, but most often it's bilateral. There is a recurrent myoclonic jerks with sudden flexion or extension of body and limb. So flexion, extension, you all know, and then based on that, understand this. Then what could be the cause of the seizure and epilepsy? The seizure are the result of a shift in normal balance of excitation and inhibition. As I told, it can be because of the reduction in inhibitory potential and or there is an increase in the excitation transmission. So when there is imbalance between this, then there may be seizure and epilepsy episode. fever may come in for Bell seizure, endogenous factor may get involved in genetic type of seizure. Then epileptogenetic factor like head trauma, stroke, infection, abnormality of CNS development also may cause epilepsy or seizure. If there is underlying epilepsy, there can be many precipitating factor. So if the person has physical stress, or the person has not slept for a long period of time, there is sleep deprivation, there is hormonal change, there is a menstrual cycle. So these are the precipitating factor. Underlying epilepsy is there, but with these type of physical conditions, the person may get the acute seizure attack. There is also a term called reflex epilepsy, in which based on the reflex of a person, the epileptic episode may appear. Like photic stimuli, if the person is seeing TV and then some shot of flashing of light comes and in the TV of seeing some scene, then because of that photic stimuli appears and then epilepsy, the person may feel seizure episode. Sorry. Then flashing light and the visual pattern is also responsible for this. Music, reading, eating, all may give reflex epilepsy. What are the basic principles of drug therapy? See, a single drug is quite effective in this epilepsy. So you need to prescribe a single drug, multiple drugs is not needed, and then follow-up regular dosing is necessary, and the person will be back to its normal life. So you start low dose and then go slowly. Follow up the patient, see the condition, see the improvement, and then based on that you modify your treatment regimen. Then increase the dose of that drug to either seizure control or toxicity. So if the seizure control is not proper, so increase it, or if the toxicity is appearing, then decrease the dose or change the drug. If a drug does not control seizure without toxicity, switch to another appropriate drug used alone and again increase the dose until seizure control occurs or toxicity intervenes. So you need to remember this. These are the various types and drugs of choice of partial simple or partial complex seizure. In this drug of choice may be carbamazepine, phenytoin and valproate. These are the alternative drugs for partial seizure. Generalized tonic-clonic seizure, the drug of choice can be from carbamazepine, phenytoin and valproate. Whereas alternative may be among these lamotrigine, topiramate and phenobarbital. Absent seizure, drug may be from ethosuximide or valproate. And for alternative, drug can be from lamotrigine and clonazepam. Atypical absence, atonic or myoclonic seizure, the drug of choice can be valproate and alternative can be clonazepam. For status epilepticus, which I discussed yesterday, status epilepticus is a seizure episode which remains there for more than 30 minutes. And in that, the drug of choice can be from diazepam, lorazepam, or fosphenytoin or phenytoin. So lorazepam or fosphenytoin, I told in the prescription of yesterday class. Then alternative drug may include phenobarbital and general anesthetic. So this was all about the prescription on grand mal epilepsy. Now coming to the prescription on migraine. So migraine is a very common episode or common type of disorder nowadays, seen in all type of all group of patients, whether the patient is young, child, or old. So here, usually the person feel pain, throbbing type of pain in the head, and usually it is there in the one part, one side of the head, and or different types are there, but most commonly the person feels a one-sided headache. So there are several types of migraine headache, but most are characterized by severe pain on one or sometimes both of the side of the head. And it can move from one side to another. nausea may be there, dizziness may be there, visual disturbance may be there, and it can be caused by dilatation or constriction of blood vessel in the head. So what is migraine? It's a severe, throbbing, pulsating headache, usually unilateral headache, few hours to a few days in the duration. So it may remain there for few hours or for 1 or 2 days also it may be there. Sometimes when it is severe form or for prolonged period, it is associated with nausea, vomiting, sensitivity to light is there and sound is there, and flashes of light and loose motion may appear. In the types, there can be classical migraine with aura, when the person gets through that he is going to have the attack, and without aura, which is common, so it is commonly seen. What is the pathophysiology of migraine? It is a pulsatile. It may be because of the dilatation of temporal or cranial vessels. In that, the person will get pulsatile headache. So dilatation of temporal or certain cranial vessels. There is a vascular theory also for the migraine. At initial, there will be vasoconstriction or shunting of blood through carotid arteriovenous anastomosis, causing cerebral ischemia, and because of this the person is feels migraine. Neurogenic theory, the depression of cortical electrical activity followed by depression. Then we have migraine attack with, based on histological studies, sterile neurogenic perivascular edema or inflammation. So there can be mild migraine, moderate migraine, or severe migraine. So in mild form, NSAIDs and antiemetics can be given. Usually NSAIDs will do, antiemetic is not needed in mild type because nausea and vomiting is not there in mild type. Otherwise, if it is there, then it can be opted for. Among NSAIDs, ibuprofen, paracetamol, naproxen, mefenamic acid, diclofenac can be given. Usually people prefer the paracetamol because of safety. Antiemetic like metoclopramide or domperidone can be chosen from. Then moderate case, if there is throbbing headache for 6 to 24 hours, nausea may be there, vomiting is there, then NSAIDs, any NSAIDs among these, then antiemetic should be given, or a specific drug like ergot or sumatriptan can be given. In severe form, when it goes for 1 to 2 days and 2 to 3 attack per month, along with the vomiting, and when the person is totally incapacitated, that is regarded as severe migraine, and in that, NSAIDs should be given. A specific migraine drug like ergot along with caffeine or sumatriptan is given. Also, prophylactic regimen should be given to reduce the further chances of migraine attack. Ergotamine, it's an ergot alkaloid, remember ergot alkaloid, and this is an agonist of 5-HT1B and 1D. It causes constriction of dilated temporal vessel, so it acts, the mechanism is on the basis of the dilatation theory. So there will be constriction, the constriction of carotid AV shunt channels and reduction of neurogenic inflammation and leakage of plasma in dura pattern. Dihydroergotamine, it is equally effective as ergotamine and preferred for parenteral administration. It is not much popular nowadays because the safer drugs are there. It has no prophylactic value and there can be adverse effects also. But the combination is possible with caffeine, paracetamol and belladonna. Next, the drug is sumatriptan, which is selective 5-HT1B and 1D agonist. Again, this is a selective drug of this receptor. There is no interaction of adrenergic with adrenergic, dopaminergic and cholinergic receptor or GABA. So the adverse effect is lesser. Mechanism, it blocks this receptor mediated vasoconstriction, mediated constriction, dilatation of extracerebral blood vessels. Constriction of arteriovenous shunt of carotid artery, Then inhibition of release of 5-HT and suppression of impulse transmission in trigeminal vascular system. Here the thing is there, I will show you the strength of the somatropin should be given. It is better tolerated than ergotamine, used in onset of acute attack, and 50 to 100 milligram can be started with for this drug. For prophylaxis of migraine, there are many drugs. When there is a severe migraine attack, then it should be avoided and prevented. Further attack is prevented by giving some drug like propranolol or timolol, but metoprolol or atenolol should not be given. Tricyclic antidepressant like amitriptyline can be given. Calcium channel blocker like verapamil and anticonvulsant like valproic acid, carbapentin, and topiramet can be given. The next CCR is related with cardiovascular system. So digoxin it will be related with. So I'll be discussing that. The cardiac glycoside. So the name is specific is glycoside, where you have a sugar moiety and where you have a non-sugar moiety, and then those are linked with a ethyl linkage. And the digitoxin and digoxin are the examples of this, and those are obtained from Digitalis purpura and Digitalis lenata. Pharmacological action on heart, there is it causes dose-dependent force of contraction, more complete emptying of failing and dilated heart, and that's why, and that's the reason why this drug is given. It causes complete emptying and increase in force of contraction is there. Rate is decreased and the resting membrane potential is also decreased. In blood vessel, it has a vasoconstrictor action and increases the total peripheral resistance. Systolic BP may increase, diastolic is decreased in CHF patient. Kidney related effect, diuresis in CHF patient is seen. CNS higher dose causes CTZ activation. Uses congestive heart failure, like systolic dysfunction, or if there is diastolic dysfunction. Cardiac arrhythmia like atrial fibrillation or atrial flutter. Atrial fibrillation when the rate is more than 500, whereas atrial flutter when there is rate of atrium more than 200, or it varies from 200 to 350 per minute. So in there, and adverse effect can be cardiac or extracardiac. Cardiac adverse effect like arrhythmia or partial or complete AV block. Whereas extracardiac include anorexia, nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, malaise, headache, restlessness, disorientation, and hypokalemia. Now coming to this part, the prescription part. So the first question is, prescribe for a case of grand mal epilepsy. As I told, there will be many part of the prescription. You need to write in this format. You have to remember this. So you in examination also you have to write in this format. Maximum alteration can be of drawing one box, and inside the box you need to write all these things. So doctor's name with degree, registration number, address, and contact with date. This is doctor's detail. Then comes the first patient's detail. Name, age, sex, weight of the patient, and address. Weight of the patient is very much important when the patient is infant, or when the patient is in childhood. Diagnosis, grand mal epilepsy, or the another name is tonic-clonic epilepsy. The drug of choice is phenytoin, so tablet phenytoin sodium, 100 milligram. And then one tablet has to be taken TID, which is terindiol, or 3 times a day, and the person has to report after 7 days about the improvement or deterioration. Then last it will signature. Other than phenytoin, carbamazepine and valproic acid can also be opted for. But phenytoin is the drug of choice. Then coming to the prescribed for a case of acute attack of migraine. So when there is acute attack of migraine, I am taking as a severe form of migraine. See, it depends. If you are taking it as an acute attack, but a mild attack or moderate attack, then the treatment would differ. Usually in mild to moderate cases, you need not give antiemetic drug and sumatriptan is not generally preferred. Whereas in case of severe form, these are only preferred drugs. At the same time, when there is mild or moderate cases, the case can be controlled or the pain can be relieved with NSAIDs only. Maximum is, in moderate case, you may need to give antiemetic drug. So I am taking this attack as severe form of the attack where there will be need of giving triptans in parenteral form. So here doctor's name, registration number, address and contact details of doctors, and then this prescription part with diagnosis as acute attack of migraine. And the first drug is injection sumatriptan, 6 milligrams subcutaneously and may be repeated once within 24 hours if required. Antiemetic drug can be combined with the injection metoclopramide, 10 milligram IV stat. One tablet to be taken immediately. Sorry, here there won't be a tablet. There won't be a tablet. This is a mistake. So here it would be injection to be given a stat. That's it. Okay, so this direction part you kindly excuse, ignore it. Check. So, hello, yeah, so I'm back here. You can see that inject this drug stat immediately and then signature. Next, we have criticized, correct and read the following prescription for an adult suffering from congestive cardiac failure. So here the wrong prescription is this, where there is three drugs prescribed: tablet digoxin 2.5 milligram, one tablet per day orally. Then tablet furosemide 200 milligram, one tablet per day orally, and tablet quinidine 200 milligram, one tablet per day orally. You can see, you have to criticize all the part, everything, the drug, the prescription, the parts of prescription, the way it's written, the doses in which it is given, the doses form in which it is given, the frequency, the duration, the signature, everything you need to criticize. So based on that, there is no superscription in the prescription, no super name, no details of the patient, no details of the doctor. There is no RX, there is no date, there is no weight, nothing is there. So that you need to write. Then you need to write that the name of the drug is not written in a capital form, and then there is no signature. Those things, general thing you need to write, and then coming to the specific thing like digoxin. Indication is correct, digoxin is given in CHF only, but the dose is incorrect. It is available in 0.25 milligram tablet. Furosemide, again, the indication is correct. It is given in congestive heart failure also, but the dose of furosemide is incorrect. It is in the 400 milligram tablet, 40 milligram tablet. Quinidine is contraindicated in CCF because it is pro-arrhythmic in patient with heart failure, and quinidine is myocardial depressant and can aggravate the failure. So this drug should not be given in congestive heart failure case. So you have to write specifically. So what should be the correct prescription? This is the correct way of writing the prescription, where you have the doctor's details, where you have the patient's details, then RX is there, diagnosis is there, and then drug's name is there in capital. So tablet furosemide, 40 milligram. I am taking it as a chronic episode, chronic condition of congestive heart failure, okay? So tablet furosemide, 40 milligram. One tablet to be taken twice daily for 7 days. And then tablet enalapril. Enalapril is what? Captopril and enalapril. So AC inhibitor, and it is given 5 milligram and one tablet to be taken twice daily for 7 days. Review after 7 days, and this is the subscription. Dispense above drug for a week. Direction you already have given here at after just after that drug name, so no need to give the direction to the patient again. Maximum is that you can write here that review after 7 days. And then lastly, signature comes. Now, doctors and most of the association are advising to write the direction after every drug. So you need to write this way. And then later on, the signature. So all parts are completed in this description. So this was all about the two prescription and one CCR, the congestive heart failure, then the migraine prescription was on migraine, and then epilepsy, grand mal epilepsy. You need to jot it down in your record, the same thing which I have told, and then be ready for the examination. Thank you so much.